Hello and welcome back to the Grandmaster Division of the International Championship. My third game is ahead of us today, and yeah, my first game of the season was a four-player game and I was able to win it. Then I lost a three-player game, meaning that I have a fine start with two games finished and 6 points. Not a perfect start, but also not a very bad start. We can also see at the top that Watsinets, the champion of the last season, already again has quite a lot of points, so a very strong start for him. And my next game will be a four-player game against Payada, Footloop and Siphon. And as you can see, those three players are at the bottom of the league at the moment. Of course, not that many games have finished already. Siphon, for example, is only one game finished. But still, it could be that those three players have to fight against relegation this season. And it also means that maybe if I should lose this game, it could also get a little bit dangerous for me. Then giving points to all of the players that are behind me. On the other hand, if I should win this game, then I probably don't have to be too much concerned about getting relegated at the end. So might be an interesting game in that regard. And now without further ado, we are gonna take a look at the game. I'm in the last position in this game, and as always, we are gonna first of all take a look at the Leaders and Wonders. And we can see that there's not the most science synergy in H3. There is Steve Jobs, so that's one leader, but no Bill Gates, no Sid Meier, no Einstein, also no Space Flight. There is the Manhattan Project. Then we have Pierre, also together with the Internet. We have Hollywood, together with Chaplin and Fleming, so that could be something for the military. We have Churchill and Mahatma Gandhi. And then there's also Mandela, who maybe could work with the colonization strategy, because in H2 we have the Suez Canal and James Cook. We have the Ocean Liner Service, but no Maria this game. We have two military action leaders and Robespierre to maybe go for low science strategy. We have Darwin and Shakespeare as some culture leaders. We have Nobel and also James Watt, maybe to catch up with the economy in H2. In H1 we have St. Peter's Basilica, we have the Great Wall, but no Imagi Castle. The Machu Picchu is there, Universitas is there. And for the leaders, we have Jan Žižka, but no Joan of Arc. We have Genghis Khan and Nostradamus as some more strength leaders. Of course, also Saladin can help with the strength. We have Leonardo, but no Gutenberg. Columbus is there, so that could also be very nice, getting Columbus and then maybe going for Suez Canal, maybe for Cook later on. And we also have Michelangelo, who is maybe more situational, but there are some strong wonders for him. Machu Picchu works nice with him, St. Peter's Basilica, Universitas is also a strong wonder to build, so it could be a game where Michelangelo could be quite strong. Footloop is in the first position, and he picks Cleopatra, doesn't want to pick one of those wonders. He is basically guaranteed that he gets a wonder at the next turn. And so he takes Cleopatra now. If he takes, for example, Rome Roads or Stonehenge, then Payada gets Cleopatra and a wonder. That would be quite a strong start for him. On the other hand, now if maybe Payada takes one of those wonders, then Siphon could also get quite a strong start with getting Hammurabi and a wonder. But Footloop like this has a relatively strong leader and will get a wonder almost for certain. Then Payada picks the Rome Roads, together with the Urban Growth, doesn't want to go for Hammurabi. And that leaves Siphon with the option to go for Hammurabi and a Stonehenge. And if I remember it correctly, then in the interview of after the last season, the winner of the last season, Watsinets, wrote that Hammurabi plus Stonehenge might be the best start that you can get. Or definitely one of the strongest, and Siphon gets this, and we are gonna see how it will work out, but it for certainly is a very strong start, because he gets a leader and a wonder already, and I would say both the leader and the wonder are also quite strong, work relatively nice together, and so that is probably quite a strong start for him. And then it's my turn. I could just take maybe Ashoka or Aristotle together with the Richland, and then I could maybe hope I would probably get Acropolis or Colossus. Maybe could, if I for example go for Aristotle and get some additional science from him, I could maybe even skip the HA wonder, hoping maybe to get an early Universitas or something like this. But then when I don't take the library, Footloop gets the library together with Cleopatra, which I think is quite nice for him. And it just felt better for me to pick the library, and hopefully I can maybe either get one of those leaders or one of the leaders that will be revealed, for example Confucius. Maybe also Homer could be totally fine with the library. Moses is also a fine leader, so yeah, I was hoping that I will get one of those for one civil action at my next turn. And of course I also want to pick the rich land. I could also take one of those, but I think the rich land is fine, because then I will have four resources at my third turn, meaning that if a development is revealed that gives me two resources, I can then finish the library very early already on turn three. Footloop goes for Cleopatra, has no library available now for him, but he can build a lab, and then he goes for the Acropolis, increasing his population. He could maybe think about taking the stockpile, then he would be guaranteed to build a step and a mine at the next turn, but it also costs a lot of civil actions, and he doesn't have a free population. I mean, he could maybe just stop seeding, but it costs a lot of civil actions, and with that it maybe is just fine to increase population and to not take the stockpile, and maybe either skipping the mine or not using Cleo's resource for one turn. Payada goes for the lab, increases population, and then takes the engineering genius. So it's an interesting choice, because he doesn't take an HA leader, but the thing is, both Aristotle and Ashoka need a lot of civil actions to work very nicely, and with the Rome roads, most of the times you don't have that many free civil actions, so Payada maybe doesn't like either of those leaders too much in this situation, isn't willing to pay an additional civil action for one of those leaders, could maybe think about of Confucius. I think that could also be an idea, going for Confucius, and then electing him, building either lab or mine. But like this, he gets the engineering genius, and can maybe, if some resources are revealed, already finished the Rome roads, maybe could have thought about building a mine, and he could do this for certain, but then he also would miss out on some science. And then we will see if he maybe goes for leader at the next turn. Xiphon elects Hammurabi, builds a mine, and then he's just grabbing the knights. I think that makes sense. He could increase his population, but then he can just take one HA yellow card, can't even pick two of them, because only one is in one civil action, so I think it makes a lot of sense to just pick the knights. Knights, I think, is a very important technology in 3 and 4 player games, and like this, he has this already in hand, and that will maybe help him to not be the weakest later on when the event deck is flipped. At my turn, I have three leaders that I can choose from, and I think all leaders could work. I'm in last position, so going for Confucius is maybe a little bit dangerous, because if the deck is flipped very quickly, then I could maybe get hit by some strength events, because I am one turn behind very often. So it could maybe be an idea to just go for Aristotle. But I still like Confucius quite a lot, and so I went for him at the end, but I think also going for Aristotle could work, and even Moses could be fine, but I think I prefer the science leaders over him, and I went for Confucius at the end. And that also means, that was also one reason I think, that Payada only has Moses available for him now, because Aristotle will be discarded on Footloop's turn, and I take Confucius. If I take Aristotle, then Payada could also still go for Confucius, and so that is also a little bit of a denial pick. But I think even without that reasoning, I maybe would still go for Confucius. And then I just build my mine, increase my population, and maybe I can finish the library already if some additional resources are revealed. I draw the immigration, which is maybe a little bit too swingy, or maybe I don't want to seed this without having a source of additional happy faces, but I can seed maybe the plunder in for one additional science. Development of markets is revealed, meaning that with the two additional resources I could finish the library at the next turn. And it also is quite nice for Footloop, because thanks to the additional resource he can now build one stage of the Acropolis, while also building a mine, and then he is increasing his population, going into consumption very early, but he has the Acropolis, so missing out on the religion would be even more painful for him, and so he doesn't want to risk that, increases population and takes the cultural heritage. Payada opens the development of science, everyone gains two additional science, and thanks to the resource, Payada can just finish the Rome roads. He doesn't want to go for Moses and instead just use all of his civil actions to finish the Rome roads. It's definitely not bad. Having finished this already, this early next turn he can maybe build his mine, but he misses out on an HA leader, and missing out on a leader is quite costly because it isn't only cost civil actions to go for a leader, and the leader then give quite a lot of value. But I can also understand that Payada doesn't want to delay his Rome roads. Then he maybe would have to build a mine, increase population, would go into consumption. Maybe it could be fine, but it is maybe also fine to just go for the Rome roads. But if he has to wait a long time for a new leader, then he could maybe regret it. The knights stayed on three civil actions after Footloop's turn. Siphon already has a copy of knights, meaning at my turn I will have to decide whether I want to grab those knights or not. Siphon this turn increases population, builds a lab, and again for the second turn in a row is grabbing a card for three civil actions, this time the iron. And this time I'm not that certain if it is the right move, but I think it might be the right move, because iron and Stonehenge is working very nicely together. He could of course maybe go for irrigation and then maybe the urban growth, or irrigation and frugality and rich land or some stuff like this. Then he would also have something to upgrade and get some yellow cards in addition to that. But of course, an early iron is quite strong with the Stonehenge. You definitely have the science available to support that. He can upgrade his resource production before finishing the Stonehenge. So, I think that leaves him with some very strong next turns. And because of that, it might be worth it to grab it for three civil actions, even though you already grabbed a card for three civil actions at the last turn. Then, as I said, I don't want to see the migration in, and so I see the plunder and the development of crafts is revealed, so even more resources. And because of the additional resource, I even take food from the development of markets, because I think I have enough resources for now. But as you can see, I don't finish the library. If I finish the library, then I don't have enough civil actions to grab the knights, and I just think that having knights is very strong. And just helps a lot later on, hopefully when I draw a tactic, or if I maybe can copy a tactic to get enough strength. And also the deck is progressing very quickly, and it probably also will in the future with me having Confucius, so the knights already might be needed in the near futures to avoid being the weakest. And so instead of getting an additional science production from the library, I build a lab, increase my population, that means that I get into consumption early, but thanks to the food that I got from development of markets, I can still increase my population again at the next turn. And I think it definitely is better to have the additional food instead of the resource, because now being at only zero food and plus one production could be quite bad, because I don't have a free population that I can put into military, and even when I take the food, I still have enough resource to finish the library at the next turn if I want to do this. Then I draw two cards, a colonization card and a trade routes agreement. Footloop finishes the Acropolis this turn, goes for irrigation, develops it and starts upgrading it. That makes it that he can for certain go for a new population at the next turn, and he also just upgrades something, gets some additional food production while still being able to use Cleopatra. Payada goes for the Code of Laws, has now 5 civil actions, increases population, and then builds his third mine. So now his 3 mines, 2 labs, already Rome Roads finished, and the Code of Laws, but having the Code of Laws also means that he is now at only 3 science at the next turn, meaning that he doesn't really have enough to go for military technology. But there are 3 events, so it might be that he can still increase his military in time. Siphon seeds and the development of trade routes is open, so even more resources and food. And Siphon goes for iron this turn, that definitely makes a lot of sense. Can go for 2 upgrades already and then increases population. Takes the rich land, can use this for his last iron upgrade. Could even upgrade his mine and finish the Stonehenge at the next turn, so he's definitely a strong start. Again, I don't want to seed the immigration, and so I seed the trade routes agreement as a 1 science event. The development of agriculture is open, so a lot of developments were revealed that give additional resource or blue cubes, so the players maybe have some corruption problems. Now, And again, I could finish the library this turn, but again, I delay it. I could finish it, and then I would have to increase my population to get out of corruption. The thing is, the deck will flip very quickly, and yeah, and if Footloop see it, then I will be the weakest, maybe even for multiple seats. And of course, I myself also want to see this at the next turn with having Confucius. And so I think it is very important to get stronger here, even though it delays the library for at least one more turn. But I can build one knight. Sadly, I have no tactic yet, but I think it's still better to invest into a military technology or in an upgraded military unit instead of just building warriors. And no, I don't want to build a second knight, because then I can't finish the library at the next turn unless I get additional resource, but the resource developments are already out of the deck, and so I only build one knight. Hopefully that will be enough to not be the weakest at my next turn, so that I can see it without too much risk. And then I have one civil action left. I could just build one stage of the library, or I could take one of those cards, and at the end I went for one of those cards, and I went for the Bread and Circuses. Now, the thing is, first of all, I have immigration in hand, so with having the Bread and Circuses that might get or might become a playable event. And yeah, also when we take a look at the leaders, we can see that there's Darwin, there's Pierre, so there is some synergy for the Bread and Circuses. And yeah, and just getting this Bread and Circuses might mean that I can put one more worker into military, which also maybe helps me to get strongest. The H1 happy face illusions are definitely not that effective, but I think all of those reasons combined are were strong enough for me that I picked the Bread and Circuses instead of maybe picking the Urban Growth, or instead of just building one stage of the library. Then I draw the Open Borders Agreement. Footloop increases his population 2 times, upgrades one of his farms again, so he can again increase his population also the next turn, and then he wants to use the resource of Clio again, and thanks to the Acropolis he can build a third lab, even though he is still on despotism, and like this he increases his science production and is also able to use the resources of Clio. Hayada takes the swordsman for 2 civil actions, develops the swordsman. Now he has to get out of corruption, but he can do this with increasing his population 2 times, and with building 2 swordsmen is now the strongest and was able to get out of corruption. But he is now very low in science, which might prevent him from upgrading his civilization at the next 1 or 2 turns. Siphon builds 1 stage of the Stonehenge that allows him to develop the knights, then he builds 1 knight, upgrades his last mine, and reveals the medieval army tactics, so this turn he can't use Hammurabi, but he also goes up to 5 strength, and no. At least the good news is that I now have the medieval army available in 2 turns, so I definitely will have a tactic for my knights, so that's at least the good news, and also even more good news is that I I'm still stronger, but also there was no event seeded, meaning that there is still one HA development on top of the deck. And this turn I actually seed the immigration into the deck, and the development of planning is revealed. And for the development of planning, we can see that the options are development of politics, settlement, or civil life, and I think here it's very clearly that the development of settlement is the best development. I seeded the immigration because at the moment no player has any happy faces. And yeah, so if it is opened immediately, then it's basically a neutral event. Maybe another player will need the population more than me, but yeah, it would still, everyone would gain 1 population, that would maybe be fine. But at my next turn I can go for Bread and Circuses, and then maybe I could even be the only player, or the one player who gets 1 additional population out of this event. There is also definitely a risk, for example Siphon might finish the Stonehenge the next turn, and then he is the only one with 1 happy face maybe, and if I then want to seed, then Siphon could be the only one to get 1 additional population out of this, so there's a bit of a risk. It could just be a neutral win, but it also has the potential to just grant me an additional population, and with that I seeded that into the deck because I want to keep my colonization card. I don't want to put the Open Borders Agreement into the deck. I could also think about offering this, but my plan was to keep it in hand and maybe offer it as soon as I don't have Confucius any longer, because I have now the knowledge about this tactic. If I would not have this knowledge, then maybe I would of it already, but like this, I am willing to wait a little bit with this pact. And with my last civil action, I then grab the monarchy at the next turn. If I see that, will be at 8 science, meaning that I have enough science to go for monarchy and for bread and circuses. And that means, no, I will get my 5th civil action, my 3rd military action, with that maybe the open borders agreement is also not that urgently needed. And I also can go for bread and circuses, maybe copying the medieval army tactics so that I can go up to 6 strength and also that I'm prepared for the immigration that is in the deck. Then I draw 2 events, the scientific breakthrough and the pestilence. Footloop still wants to use Cleopatra, there's no H1 leader at the row at the moment, and so yeah, he needs a new project, and he takes the Great Wall for that, and yeah, that is definitely quite a strong wonder. He can build one stage of it, takes the Theocracy, and then builds one warrior to get out of corruption. The Theocracy is quite a cheap government form for him, with having the Acropolis, and a happy face might help to justify his 3rd lab that he built for a while ago. Bayada increases population, takes the breakthrough, takes the iron, and builds one religion. I wasn't too happy to see this, because now he could actually get one additional worker out of the immigration. Yeah, and he takes the iron, but he is still at 4 science at the moment, the next turn, so he might not be able to go for this. On the other hand, he knows that I'm Confucius, and so he's maybe hoping for a 1 science Confucius event, and then he actually would be able to go for iron already at the next turn. Siphon doesn't see it, he takes the Code of Laws, then he builds 2 stages of the Stonehenge, and thanks to Murabi has just also 1 civil action left that he can use to use the science of the Stonehenge to develop the Code of Laws already. Then he finishes the Stonehenge and goes for 1 more knight, is the strongest now, and yeah, is now at 5 civil actions, and has very strong resource production, is the strongest, and still has a very strong start. Then this turn I see it again. I could think about the pestilence, but yeah, ideally I would like to. It could be fine. Ideally I would like to go for 1 more knight, 1 more warrior, and the bread and circuses, and then I probably will also gain 1 more population out. I thought that maybe Footloop has a lot of food production. Bayada has the additional yellow token from the Rome Road, so the other players also have some free population, and I at the end rather went for the scientific breakthrough. At least I have some additional science production, and it also takes quite a while until the pestilence will be revealed, and I don't really know how much it would benefit or hurt me when it is revealed, so I rather went for the scientific breakthrough. I was very happy to see that the immigration isn't revealed, and instead it is the good harvest, so some additional food for everyone. And that means that this turn I can prepare for the immigration, I can go for the monarchy, I can develop the bread and circuses, building one, copying the medieval army tactics, so now I'm one of the 2 strongest and I definitely want to grab the engineering genius. For my last civil action, I could just increase my population, but I could also take 1 more card, for example the swordsman, to maybe be prepared for more H2 tactics, or maybe also the reserves. And at the end, I indeed went for the reserves, because if the immigration isn't revealed before my next turn, then I will have 5 plus 2, 7 food if I play it for food, so I could play it for food, increase my population 2 times. And yeah, so I thought it could be quite nice, but it's not the only reason. Another reason is that I am at 4 resource at the next turn, but with 2 additional resource from the reserves, I would be able to build 1 more knight and 1 more warrior, which could help me to be the strongest and be prepared for the strength events that might be in there. So I think the reserves just opens up some options, and so I went for that. It's also a little bit risky, I don't have knowledge about rats, so I could get punished for this decision. And maybe just increasing population would also be fine, but I could maybe get an additional population out, or what is maybe even more important, I could get the resources to build a knight and a warrior, and with that I was willing to risk it and to take the reserves. And at least I have knowledge about some of those events. There are still 2-1 science event from Confucius in this, the migration, and so are only 2 unknown events, and hopefully then it is justifiable. I can justify this risk. Footloop builds a warrior and goes for the Theocracy, builds one stage of the Great Wall, takes the swordsman, develops the swordsman, upgrades two times so he finally isn't the weakest any longer, and then he will have corruption, but it's only food corruption and he really has a lot of food. And now, if he doesn't have knowledge about rats, then he really has to be very careful now. Or then he has to hope that there are no rats revealed, because it would be a very, very big... it would be very bad for him. There was no Confucius event revealed, so Peada can't go for the iron, but he has just enough science to go for the alchemy, so he goes for that instead, goes for two upgrades, is now at 4 science production, and takes the knights. Reveals the phalanx tactic, so the next turn Ida can maybe go for iron and two upgrades, but he probably wants to get stronger, so instead he might go for knights, building one knight, and then he gets plus 5 strength out of that. Can maybe also upgrade the last warrior to get even more strength. Siphon seeds, and there's actually the rebellion, so building the bread and circuses was not only nice for the immigration, but also for the rebellion. Maybe that was the reason why Peada built a religion, maybe he had knowledge about this, maybe also Siphon seeded it with having the additional happy face from the Stonehenge, but yeah, definitely was happy that I didn't open this at my last turn when I still had one unhappy face. Siphon builds one more warrior, is now at 10 strength, and then he increases his population 2 times, goes to Michelangelo, elects Michelangelo, takes the Machu Picchu, and builds 2 stages of the Machu Picchu. Now, that's definitely interesting, and it kind of looks like he adapts the playstyle of Vorzinyets here, first going for Stonehenge and Hammurabi, which is the strongest HA leader and wonder combination according to Vorzinyets, and now he is going for Michelangelo, a leader that Vorzinyets uses definitely more often than other players. Yeah, but I think it definitely makes sense to go for Michelangelo here, because with the Machu Picchu you will have lots of resource production, and when you take a look at the Leaders and Wonders, then we can see that there are still 2 very strong H1 Wonders available for him. The St. Peter's Basilica could be very strong, but also the Universitas, and with building 2 stages, he is prepared to just finish the Machu Picchu the next turn, and then grabbing the next Wonder, getting a lot of value out of that, and also there are some strong H2 Wonders, like Ocean Liner Service, Harvard College, maybe if he gets some colonies, then the Suez Canal could be strong, also the Gremlin if he maybe has additional happy faces from the St. Peter's Basilica. So that could indeed be a very strong Michelangelo, it could work out very nicely, and yeah, so he goes for that and will have lots of resource production once he finishes the Machu Picchu. Then it's my turn. I see the historic territory this turn. I could also see the pestilence. I have some free population, but again, I was not too sure if this really will be nice for me, and so instead I seeded a colony that's maybe not too swingy. And the immigration is revealed, and actually I am the only player with 2 happy faces, so I'm the only player who gets 1 additional population out of that. So that worked out very nicely for me. I have now lots of free populations, so maybe the pestilence would be quite nice. Of course I didn't know if I indeed will be the only player when I seeded this event in, so... Yeah, but the pestilence, I still have it in hand, so I could maybe seed it still in later on when I have more knowledge about whether I will need all of my population or not. It might be the last turn in H1 for me. I could also maybe have 1 more turn, but it definitely might be the last, so it's time to replace Confucius now, and Saladin is available for 1 civil action, will give me my 6th civil action, and so that is quite nice, getting him for 1 civil action. And then I take the rich land, I build one knight, play the resource, so now we can see why the reserves is definitely not bad for me. And I can build also one more warrior, I take the patriotism, I'm now the strongest. I don't have anything upgraded yet, I have some additional science production thanks to the library, but at least I'm the strongest, and I have 6 civil actions from now on. So I think I have definitely not a bad position, probably not the strongest. I think Siphon has probably the stronger position, because he certainly will get either Universitas or St. Peter's Basilica, and then I think he could have get quite a big boost from all of those wonders that he potentially gets, but apart from this, I think I have a fine position. But I don't have anything upgraded yet. But there is an iron coming down the row. Footloop is the last only other player without the iron, and he really will struggle to get out of corruption, so I think I might have a chance to get the iron at the next turn. It's relatively late, but I need to upgrade something, and I have the rich land, meaning that I can go for 2 upgrades at the next turn if I want to. Footloop goes for Columbus. He also needs to replace his HA leader. And then he still uses Cleopatra one last time with building one stage of the Great Wall. Increases his population 2 times and then upgrades one warrior. Is now at 8 strength and yeah. But he might be the weakest when Payada goes for one knight now. Which he does. He goes for one knight, is now at 10 strength, also upgrades the warrior, is now at even at 11 strength, takes the breakthrough, and then he takes the St. Peter's Basilica away. Maybe doesn't want to give Siphon the St. Peter's Basilica, but it's also a strong wonder for himself. And no, and for Siphon it's maybe a bit bad, but on the other hand he can just go for Universitas. It's also a very strong wonder for him, especially because he has still relatively low science production, still needs a government form, so the Universitas is maybe even stronger. I mean, St. Peter's Basilica of course also produces a lot of culture with Michelangelo, and so maybe that would be the stronger wonder, but Universitas is definitely a great alternative. So, yeah, but it's of course also a strong wonder for Payada, and he definitely takes options away from Siphon. Siphon finishes the Machu Picchu, takes the Universitas, and then he just picks the Britain Circuses. He can finish the Universitas at the next turn. I mean, Britain Circuses for 2 is probably fine. On one hand, it's not really a nice technology to have when you have that much resource production. On the other hand, it will produce some additional culture with Michelangelo. He can definitely can use it, because getting the 2 happy faces will allow him to build a knight now, and even when he loses the 2 yellow tokens, he still can avoid an uprising with it. And also there is Pierre at the end, there's Darwin, so yeah, at the end it might be the correct move to gravity, especially because the alternatives also aren't that great. A monarchy is quite late, and drama and printing press also don't look too strong. Just taking one of those yellow cards also isn't too strong, so the Brand Circus is probably the correct pick here. Then H2 starts at the beginning of my turn. Footloop loses the cultural heritage, and now that I have Saladin and not Confucius any longer, I can go for the Open Borders Agreement, and I offer it to Footloop because he's the only player who also has already 3 military actions before I offer the pact. Payada and Siphon both are at 2, so I definitely don't want to help them, so Footloop was the only player I was willing to offer this pact to, and he accepted it, so we both have 4 military actions now. Then, yeah, as I said, this turn I can go for iron, and I also do this, because yeah, I can't just take cards, then I don't have the hand space, or I maybe have the hand space for that thanks to the library, but just picking all of those H1 yellow cards I think would be bad, and instead I think it is a lot stronger to go for the iron, even though it's a little bit late, and I can go for 2 upgrades immediately, and then I have 2 civil actions left. And I actually played a patriotism to build one warrior. It's maybe not ideal to build this warrior, I rather would like to build a knight, but it still makes it that I'm at 12 strength instead of at 11, because the thing is, Footloop might finish the Great Wall. There is no Legion or Fighting Band at the moment, but maybe he has still drawn one, or maybe wants to reveal one now, and then he could go up to more than 11 strength if he has one of those tactics and finishes the Great Wall, meaning that when I stay at 11 strength, and then I could be weakest when Payada seats, and if Payada somehow increases strength again, then I could again be weakest, so this one strength could make quite a big difference. I also thought about maybe only going for one mine upgrade and going for the knight instead, but I just wanted to get those 2 upgrades in, and yeah, and so I was willing to build this warrior at the end. Maybe if I draw some colonization cards, I have now a lot of military actions, can keep a lot of cards in hand, so maybe the next deck there will be the historic territory, and then I can maybe win a colony for cheaper now with the warrior instead of the knight, so that could also be an advantage of having the warrior. And then I have 1 civil action left, and I go for the frugality here. There's a drama, there's a printing press, but I have not the most population at the moment. There is no Bach, there is no Marlene, and so I just went for the frugality, and hopefully I will be able to use it if I maybe can go for selective breeding. And then I indeed draw one colonization card and also two H2 events. And Footloop, interestingly, goes for the constitutional monarchy for three civil actions, doesn't use Columbus yet. And he has already the theocracy, but he also has the Acropolis, meaning that the conmon is quite cheap. Also, he knows that the two players after him would probably really like to get one copy of conmon. And so he goes for that, finishes the Great Wall, has then again one Happy Worker, and plays the Fighting Band. That puts him at 11 strength. He has lost the theocracy, otherwise he would be one strength, would have even one more strength, and then he takes the Urban Growth with his last civil action. He definitely can use some additional resources, and also he will be at 6 science, meaning that if, for example, Scientific Method is in the row at the next turn, then this Urban Growth makes the difference between him being able to go for this or not, thanks to the two additional resources. Yeah, no, I think it also makes sense to go for the Conmon. It's definitely a big boost for him. He has not the strongest economy, it's a fine economy, but not too strong, and if he stays in 4 civil actions, I just think he has definitely a disadvantage, but now with having more civil actions, he maybe can catch up with this economy more easier, and definitely improves his position. Payada goes for iron this turn, upgrades one time, two times, is now at 5 resource production as well, the same as I. And finally he gets a leader. He was the whole H1 without a leader, so skipping the leader I think at the end didn't really work out for him. And maybe he should have gone for one instead of the Engineering Genius, or he should have maybe still gone for Moses instead of finishing the Rome Roads. But of course he didn't know that it will take that long time until he will get a leader. And now at least he has Nostradamus, and maybe can get some culture out of seeding and get some knowledge about a future event deck. Then Siphon Seeds and a new deposits are open, so I was very happy that I just got my resource production up before this event was revealed. So like this, I at least gained 5 additional resources, and Siphon gains 8 additional resources, so he is now really swimming in resources. Can finish the Universitas and still can go for Bread and Circuses, putting him at 13 strength. He remains the strongest, is also now at 5 culture production, and if there's a strong H2 wonder the next turn, he can also grab that and maybe even finish it if it isn't on 3 civil actions. This turn I see the Emigration into the deck. I am one of the 2 strongest, I'm also one of the 2 weakest because of Nostradamus, but there's also one Confucius event still in the deck. Actually there are even 2 Confucius events still in the deck, so I know that there isn't anything bad for me. And so I see the Emigration, and yeah, just to get some more knowledge about the next event deck. And then this turn, I thought what to do. I could go for Alchemy and to upgrade my economy even longer. There's also Napoleon, and I have already Knights and Warriors, meaning that Napoleon would put me at 16 strength and would probably make me the strongest, so that I can maybe win some strength events. But if I would have gone for him, then I probably would have seeded the politics of strength. So you can already see with that I don't go for him, because the thing is, with Napoleon I would go down to 5 civil actions again. And yeah, that just felt a little bit weak. But it could be an idea to go for Napoleon, and I definitely thought about it. But there are some other strong leaders, Darwin, Nobel, maybe not even that many. So yeah, also because of that I thought about Napoleon. But at the end I went for the Alchemy. I could go for 2 Alchemy upgrades and for Napoleon, so I could for example now take Napoleon, elect him and upgrade one. I could also just take him in hand, I also thought about that, maybe keeping Saladin in the civil action, and then as soon as I maybe can benefit from him, then I could elect him, but there could be some strength events, so it would be bad to not elect him and then not be part of a nice strength event. And yeah, so that also didn't feel too great, and so at the end I just didn't go for him, and instead I did go for a lot of upgrades, for 2 upgrades of my labs, for 1 upgrade of my mine, and then I took the Cultural Heritage for 1 civil action. Going for Alchemy, it's a little bit late, but with the together with the library, I have 5 science production now, and it might be enough long term. And also in the next deck, there is the scientific breakthrough that I seeded, and with that, I think it makes even more sense to go for this additional science production now. If I should go for Napoleon, then I even have the option to get the Taj Mahal for free. So I also thought about this, maybe going for the Taj Mahal of the engineering genius. I could even finish it immediately. But there are some strong wonders, the ocean liner service, maybe Harvard College, maybe even the Suez Canal if I should maybe win the historic territory and Rovan territory. And with having the Taj Mahal, it gets more difficult to grab those wonders. On the other hand, Siphon is right in front of me, and it might be that all of the wonders that are on the row are just grabbed by him, if they are coming one at a time. I didn't like it too much to go for the Taj Mahal, but it also could be an option getting some more cultural production now. But at the end, I just went for the economy upgrades and made the decision against Napoleon and also against the Taj Mahal. Footloop goes for his colony with Columbus this turn, and he has the vast territory, so he has some additional yellow tokens now, which is definitely strong for him. He increases his population 2 times, builds an additional mine, is now at least at 4 resource production, and he has now a lot of workers with the food production that he went for very early, and with that additional yellow tokens that he has now, so he might, it might be possible for him to keep this mine for a while. Bayada, thanks to the new deposits, can finish the St. Peter's Basilica, and then he just takes the Conmon at the next turn. He has enough science to go for it, and yeah, that definitely will be very strong. And Siphon will now miss out on the Conmon, meaning that he can only go for Republic as an H2 government, and that also might mean that he will go for Napoleon, because he doesn't know if he will get strategy, and it could be quite dangerous to go into H3 with 2 military actions, and so indeed he grabs Napoleon. I was thinking about Napoleon for my next turn, because I have now drawn a war, and I could have maybe gone for Napoleon and then also for Rifleman, declaring the war already. That could have been quite interesting, and I might have done that, but Siphon takes Napoleon away, and with that also this option to go for this war. At my turn, I see the Grime Wave. It's maybe not an ideal event for me, because I definitely don't know if I will be one of the 2 strongest and not one of the 2 weakest. But I again know the event on top, so I know that there isn't anything too bad about it, and at least they have no knowledge about both of those H2 events, meaning that I can maybe prepare for them very nicely, and yeah, I just have also knowledge what events aren't there. So if now, for example, Footloop would see an H2 event, and then this could be everything, and now I have knowledge about both of those events, and that might be quite useful, and losing to the Grime Wave is also not too bad. Then the Trade Routes Agreement is revealed. In my turn, I definitely want to grab the Rifleman. Yeah, I have a bunch of warriors, and it also gives me an easy way to increase my military, and no. Yeah. I mean, there's only Siphon who doesn't have swordsmen, so I could maybe have a chance to get a second copy, but still, it could also be taken by Footloop and Payada, and I think it's very important for me to have this, so I think that's a must grab. And then I can go for 1 upgrade, I could even go for more upgrades, but then I would miss out on draws, and that already will make sure that I'm not the weakest, so I was fine with just going for 1 upgrade. And then I also take the cannons and 1 copy of Urban Growth, so I have now all military technologies. I have an easy way to increase my strength. I get this Urban Growth, I could also take this copy, then the frugality would stay on 2 civil actions for Footloop. But it just felt better to take 1 Urban Growth away from my opponents instead of leaving it there, so I went for this copy. And yeah, so it's not looking too bad. I have a decent economy. I still need either selective breeding or maybe the ocean liner service. Then I have basically everything covered. I have now a bunch of things that that help me with my military. I have a decent amount of civil military actions, but that actually might be the thing that could turn out to be a little bit of a weakness. As soon as I lose Saladin, I'm only at 5 civil actions, and that's not too that's definitely not too great, but at the moment I still have Saladin, so at the moment I think it's definitely not looking too bad for me. Then I draw the Infiltrate, the Cold War and the International Agreement, Footloop Seeds, and the Scientific Breakthrough is revealed, so I gain 5 science out of that. Footloop goes for the Cavalryman, also for the Organized Religion, increases his population, and then builds one Cavalryman, is now even at 18 strength, takes the breakthrough. Interestingly, he doesn't go for James Watt. That could be an interesting leader for him, allowing him to go for some cheap coal upgrades later on, but maybe he's still waiting for Nobel. Also Darwin, although he just gripped the Organized Religion, so that might be difficult. So there are not that many leaders that work nicely for him. Maybe James Cook could also work, but it could be an idea, I think, to just grab James Watt here. Payada Seeds. And a historic territory is revealed, and I have a bunch of colonization card. I have a free warrior, so I was willing to bid for this. It's still not completely without risks, because I'm now one strength weaker, meaning that at Siphon's turn I will be the weakest, but I still was willing to send one warrior away for that colony. Sadly, I don't have a colony in hand, otherwise it could be an idea to go for the Suez Canal at the next turn. Yeah, so that... I was hoping that... I would have liked it to have a colony in hand at the moment. Payada takes the patriotism, the selective breeding, the fission upgrade, and also the cannons, so he takes a bunch of stuff. Was going for the Conmon, and definitely also has not a bad position. Has also already a strong resource and science production, the same as me, has now even more civil and military actions, or at the moment the same amount of military actions, doesn't have the problem with losing Saladin, also has a bunch of military technologies and already has the selective breeding in hand, so his position might even be a little bit better than mine at the moment. Siphon offers me the scientific cooperation, but it was relatively clear for me that I don't want to accept this, because the problem is Siphon, with this having this pack, could go for Republic, for selective breeding and for cannons, or maybe Rifleman this turn. So he could develop three technologies, which would cost me three science, and while I have also a decent amount of science and decent science production, the thing is I don't have that many technologies that I still want to go for. I mean, I could maybe develop the cannons, but I don't have a tactic yet. I probably will go for selective breeding. There are still some blue technologies, but there isn't one on the card draw at the moment. So I just felt like I don't get enough value out of this, and so I rejected this pact. Siphon takes selective breeding and the Rifleman develops the Republic. Increases population, goes for the selective breeding for one upgrade and builds one knight, and is also going for a second upgrade. A second upgrade, of course, is not that efficient with having the Machu Picchu, but I think it will still pay off on the long run. And then he reveals the Conquistadors, which might be a tactic I will be able to use, so at least I have knowledge about this, because I still don't have an H2 tactic, but if I don't draw any tactic, then at least I can go for this at some point. Then, as I said, I kind of wanted to go for the selective breeding here, but I wasn't too sure what I want to do. No, but I definitely want to go for the selective breeding, and then I go for one upgrade, and I could just go for a second upgrade here. However, I still have this engineering genius in hand, and I kind of would like to get a wonder. The ocean liner service would have been quite nice, but now that I have selective breeding, it is maybe not that much needed, could still be nice. And also the problem is Siphon has still Michelangelo, didn't elect Napoleon yet, even though it means missing out on a card draw, because I think it's the right decision, because he has just a very strong potential, grabbing and just finishing a wonder, maybe getting the ocean liner service, maybe the Harvard College. So I think it definitely makes sense to stick to Michelangelo for a little bit longer, but it also means that the other wonders might be taken away from me. And so I thought that I maybe want to go for a wonder now, because with the engineering genius it definitely get those wonders for cheaper. As I said, I would have loved it to just have a colony in your hand now, then I would go for the Suez Canal, but like this, without having a colony and with not having that many draws left, I wasn't willing to risk it to just go for the Suez Canal without having a colony in hand. I also only have one colony, so when I don't draw one, it really would be a disaster. But instead, I went for the Kremlin, and I'm not totally sure about this decision. My thoughts were that, as I said, when I lose Saladin, I will be back to 5 civil actions, which is very few, so the Kremlin definitely helps with that. It helps me with that I can use the engineering genius, it will improve my economy. On the other hand, it also is a little bit costly, or the unhappy face is a little bit of a problem, I don't have the most population, especially now that I delay my food upgrade, which also might mean that I won't be able to go for the frugality, so that's definitely a big downside. And yeah, but I have this urban growth, I can build one bread and circuses for free, and with that I was hoping that I can somehow manage this and that the benefits will be more than the downsides of the Gremlin. But I'm not totally sure if this is the correct decision. I could also think about going for Nobel, now I leave Nobel to Footloop. It could definitely be an idea, but then I would go down to 5 civil actions. I would not be able to go for the Gremlin. I would need an additional civil action to replace Nobel's, so it felt a little bit problematic. On the other hand, Nobel might help me to go for an H3 government form at some point, but I rather was hoping to still get maybe Darwin, but going for Nobel definitely also might be an idea here. And then I upgrade one warrior so that I'm not the weakest and I still get 3 draws in. And as you can see, I draw the autonomous territory. So if I would have known this, then I would have gone for the Suez Canal. I think that is stronger than going for the Gremlin. Yeah, but of course I didn't know this, and so I went for the Gremlin instead of the Suez Canal. Footloop seats and a wealthy territory is revealed. I'm not willing to bid for this because I don't have the most population, and it also would mean that I will be the weakest, so Footloops wins it. For him it is a nice colony because he has lots of population but still not upgraded an upgraded resource production, and like this he goes for Nobel and also for coal, so that improves his economy quite a lot. Has now more resource production, more science production, and to get out of corruption he builds one more cavalryman, is still the strongest. So I think for at the end of H1 and also for some parts of H2, I think he maybe had the weakest position, but he is definitely catching up now with getting this coal and with getting Nobel. Payada seats and a Reign of Terror is revealed. Payada is the weakest, so it was important for me to get stronger, and I was definitely happy to not lose this one population. It would have been quite bad for me. Now Payada loses the population, he goes for one upgrade to his mines, goes for knights, takes the navigation, develops the navigation, takes the frugality, the wave of nationalism and the opera. The opera is of course quite nice with the St. Peter's Basilica, but it's very interesting that he doesn't go for the selective breeding, and it might already indicate something, because he is Nostradamus at the next deck. There is one event, played by Blue, and it could be rats. On the other hand, Footloop of course has upgraded food production, so it maybe is not that likely. On the other hand, it is only irrigation and he already got a lot of population out, so if he prepares for it, it might still be a nice event for him. But it is a little bit suspicious that Payada doesn't go for selective breeding here and instead just traps a bunch of cards, I think. Normally it would make sense to go for selective breeding, because he definitely will need more population. And he could do this and go for the navigation. So that's definitely interesting, but maybe he just wanted to get all of those cards. All of those cards definitely will do something for him. And the navigation also makes it that he isn't the weakest, and maybe there are some more colonies coming. Siphon seats, and there's just the ocean liner service in the card row, so we are going to see if he will grab this, and he indeed will grab this. He already has selective breedings, but he will be quite deep into his yellow bank when he loses the 2 tokens at the end, so the selective breedings will give him additional population, but not that quickly, so getting the ocean liner service on top, I think, is definitely still a good idea, especially because he can grab it for relatively cheap. With Michelangelo, I'm also getting an additional resource out of this. Then he goes for Napoleon, making him the strongest now, also giving his important third military action. And then he goes for one upgrade, for 2 upgrades, has now very strong science production, also gets the engineering genius, so this ocean liner service gets even cheaper, and he will have a very strong economy, and I think definitely has the strongest position at the moment. But he isn't taking the strategy, which is interesting. Yeah, but I think all of those other things might be more important. Maybe he could not go for the ocean liner service, but I think with the engineering genius just so cheap, and I think it's definitely still worth it. And he maybe can then go for military theory, and thanks to Napoleon, at least he has his third military action right now. At my turn, I think I see the international agreement in. And this turn I was really hoping that the immigration will be revealed. Now with this event it's a 50-50 chance, And now you can see when I talk about my turn, sadly it isn't the immigration, it is the crime wave, and it causes some problems for me. Now, first of all, I lose 3 culture and blue token, definitely not ideal, but also not too bad. And in this turn, as you can see, I go for Darwin actually. That seems quite expensive on the first look, but actually maybe isn't that expensive even. The thing is, I will grab the strategy this turn. I thought about other turns where I don't grab it, but I came to the conclusion that I want to have it. Footloop can easily use it, Payada can relatively easily use it, Siphon can use it, and I might be a little bit in danger with my strength because of the one unhappy phase and because I have not the most population. Also, I don't have a tactic yet, and I can only go for the Conquistadors maybe, so I could be in danger, and with one of my opponents getting the strategy and with me not getting the strategy, I'm even more in danger. So when I grab the strategy, I can already save one civil action with Darwin this turn, and also the next turn I won't have Saladin any longer, meaning that I also don't get the civil action back. So taking Darwin for 3 now and grabbing with him the strategy, or taking him for 1 at the next turn while not having Saladin, is actually the same civil action cost. Of course, taking him for 3 now, I have to invest more civil actions this turn, and have more 3 civil actions at the next turn, so it's of course still a difference, but it is the same civil action cost if I make the decision to go for the strategy. And so I go for Darwin, because the other thing is that the Payada also still doesn't have an H2 leader, and the only other one left is James Cook. Of course, Payada has a religion, is maybe not that nicely prepared for Darwin, but with the St. Peter's Basilica, I thought that he maybe can still somehow make him, can make use of him, and he has no colony. So maybe there are some colonies coming, and he will go for James Cook, but I thought that if I don't take Darwin now, then Payada might take him, then I only have James Cook left, who will only produce me 2 culture, will maybe help me with winning more colonies, but I don't have knowledge about any colonies, and so that's another reason why I think it's good to go for Darwin already this turn. Then I can elect him, and now you can maybe see why I really wanted to see the immigration revealed, because what I really would like to do now is to just finish the Gremlin, and then with the one civil action that I get from the Gremlin once I finish it, grab the strategy. Now, I could still do this, but with the immigration I would lose 1 population. And as I said, I really don't have the most population, and I just think I can't do this, and so I have to do my turn a little bit differently. And I still wanted to get the strategy. I go for 1 food upgrade, at least getting some more food from there. I mean, I could have increased my population at the next turn anyway, but like this I can increase it and then increase it again at the next turn as well. And then I want to use the Engineering Genius still, and that's actually all I will be doing this turn. Instead of the farm upgrade, maybe I could have built 1 more step already, but I think getting this food earlier might be quite important. And yeah. On the other hand, as you remembered, I was talking about that this might be rats, but at the game itself I maybe wasn't suspicious enough. And yeah. But at the next turn of Payada, maybe we can be even more suspicious of rats being in there. Now, next turn I hopefully can finish the Gremlin, and like this play definitely has still some downsides. Instead of upgrading the farms, I could have also just built 1 Bread and Circuses. I might have to do this at the next turn anyway, and I can do it for free with the Urban Growth. The problem is I also have to get out of corruption. That was 1 more problem, and that was also 1 big reason why I upgraded the selective breeding. I think building 1 more stage didn't get me out of corruption, because then 1 more blue token would be on the wonder instead of being here. And so I could maybe go for the Broad and Circuses, then I would be completely safe from the immigration, because at the moment, if the age ends, I again have 1 unhappy work and I would lose 1 population, so there is still the risk. However, I was willing to take this risk. I was hoping that Footloop might see he has many cards in hand, and hopefully then will also lose 1 population because of the immigration. But if he doesn't see it, again, I could be dangerous, but I didn't want to have corruption and delaying my food. So I was willing to take some risks, but I was not willing to just accept getting hit by the immigration with finishing the Gremlin already and taking the strategy. And I do draw a tactic. That one isn't too easy to use, but still better than having nothing. And I was very unhappy to see that Food Loop doesn't see it and that he actually goes for a happy face solution here. I was hoping that he maybe is rather wants to upgrade one of his mines first, but no, he is maybe he is maybe afraid of those happy face related events, especially now that the age will end, and rather is going for this. And actually, if he goes for the architecture, he can go for this religion and for one upgrade. And now with taking one more card, he would end the age, but actually he is increasing his population, which is quite interesting. And now, I think it definitely could make sense to grab the reserves. Then Payada would lose Nostradamus, which might cost him some culture. And no. But again, now it's getting even more suspicious. Footloop seeded this one event and he increases his population instead of taking the reserves and making Payada lose Nostradamus, which maybe is not even that big of a deal because maybe he isn't going for James Cook anyway. So then he doesn't have to. Would not get his civil action back anyway if he doesn't go for Cook at the next turn, and so it's maybe only three more culture for seeding, but still it could be an idea. The reserves is also useful cards, so that's another indication that there might be rats in the deck. And I was very happy about this because that gives me one more chance to avoid immigration if Payada seeds, and indeed he seeds and the immigration is revealed. I was afraid he maybe doesn't seed because he knows that I will lose a population later on. On the other hand, maybe Siphon doesn't seed and then I have another chance to prepare for it, and he also misses out on a lot of culture from Nostradamus. So yeah, he doesn't. He doesn't let me lose a population with the immigration, instead seeds and is going for the Louvre now. Finishing it immediately, that gets him out of corruption. He is now at 8 culture production. And then he takes the Cavalryman, which prepares him for maybe more H3 tactics. And again, he isn't going for the selective breeding, even though I think it would be a very strong thing to do. But again, now I think we had a lot of indicators that there are rats in the deck. And Payada then copies the Conquistador's tactics so that he, after losing Nostradamus, isn't the weakest. And then Siphon seeds, and there are indeed rats. Sadly, he revealed it already, otherwise I think with those two hints from Footloop and Payada, I was already suspicious. Then also during the game, I think at a turn before, I wasn't really suspicious of rats. And I probably wouldn't have seeded and maybe increased my population. But like this, I lose 7 food, and that's definitely quite bad, and also might be quite dangerous for me. For Siphon it's also bad, but he will get the Ocean Liner service, so it's not too bad, because he still gets one more population out, and he also can fix his happy faces with just using the Ocean Liner service, also building a Breton Circuses with 2 Breton Circuses. He sadly also is prepared for Pierre, meaning that, with him being right in front of me, it might not be that likely that I will be able to get Pierre, but Darwin is a fine leader at the moment, so I maybe also don't need Pierre. One good thing is that democracy is in the row, and I actually have enough science to go for it, so that could be a strong option for me. Also, I will be able to grab it for cheaper with Darwin. But there are also some problems, and now we can take a look at this immediately. And as you can see, I don't go for the democracy, but I have a strong alternative. There's the civil service. Both civil service and democracy basically give me 2 additional civil actions, but democracy gives me the additional culture production and the possibility to build more urban buildings. The latter is probably not needed for me, but the culture production of course would be nice to get. But the thing is, I just think that I don't have the science to justify it going into the democracy just for the culture instead of going for the civil service, because Siphon is also looking quite dangerous. He just took the military theory at his next turn. He's not enough, luckily not enough, science to go for military theory and rifleman, but even with just going for military theory, with maybe building one more knight, he could already go for quite a bunch of strength, and it could be dangerous for me, so I have to be careful about this, and in 2 turns he definitely will be able to go for military theory in Rifleman, and then it could get even more dangerous, and with going for democracy I think I would be in a very dangerous position. I'm still in a dangerous position, but with the civil service, at least I will have more science to also develop some military technologies. Yeah, I could of course also not go for the civil service, but I think the boost of the two additional civil actions is just too strong, and I think it's definitely worth the cost, even though of course I could even keep more science for military technologies if I don't go for it, but having more civil actions might also help me quite a lot with preparing for military on the long run, and of course is just very strong for me. This turn I can then finish the Gremlin. I can build one Britain Circuses, and with finishing the Gremlin out of the sudden, instead of being at 5 civil actions and 3 military actions, I am now at 8 civil actions and 4 military actions, and I could even develop the strategy now to go up to 6 military actions, so that's quite a big boost for my civil and military actions. And I definitely thought about going for the strategy. It also has the advantage that I would not be the weakest. There might be some very bad strength events I don't have knowledge about, or refugees. At least I have knowledge about politics of strength and Cold War. But I came to the conclusion that I really want to have these reserves. Because if I don't take these reserves, then I don't have a free population, and if Siphon has a war, you can maybe just go for the war, maybe even don't have increasing his population, but saying, just going for the military theory, but saying that every worker that I want to put into military will be a disband, every of these disbands would be very costly at this early of age 3. So, with having this knowledge, maybe Siphon would just go for a war like this. At least I can get one free population out. I have enough science to go for another military technology, something I don't have when I go for the strategy. And so I can get one more free population out, maybe go for one cannon, reveal the Napoleonic army, maybe just for one more military unit, reveal the classic army. So there is some threat that I can go for some more strength. And I was hoping that it will be enough to not get hit by a war, but I'm definitely in a dangerous situation still now that I lost that much food to the rats. It's also now the beginning of age 3, so we can maybe take a look at the overview. And we can see that Payada has the culture lead. It's not that big of a lead, but thanks to the Louvre, he probably will. His culture lead will get bigger and bigger at the next few turns. But apart from that, it is relatively close with the culture. Siphon, I think, has by far the best economy with his ocean liner services, 8 science production and 8 resource production. Food Loop definitely improved his position, but he also still has some issues, but has 8 resource production, 5 culture production, is the moment is behind in culture, but also has the fewest civil actions, so he might have the weakest position. But I also have some big issues, and if one of the other players goes for a big military push, then I think I might have the worst position, because Footloof at least has still 2-3 population that might help him to go build more military units, and he also has some cheap stuff that he can delete if needed. At my turn, I draw the Impact of Science. Also, the Mechanized Army could be interesting if I get tanks, so that's a fine draw, I would say. Foot Loop opens the developed territory, so there's one colony, maybe a reason why Payada went for the navigation earlier on, and he is also able to win it for one swordsman, so I think that's a nice deal for him. At least it means that Payada is now the weakest. I was quite happy about this. Foot Loop goes for the justice system, is now also at 7 civil actions, goes for the revolutionary idea, and also grabs the reserves. Payada offers the international trade agreement to Foot Loop, gaining one additional resource production for himself and giving Foot Loop one additional food production. It's interesting, I think additional food production could also be quite important for Payada, but of course it's also not bad to gain more resource production. At the moment he is going for more for upgrading his units, so for that of course resources are quite important. But here is again delaying his food production by a little bit, is only going for one instead of for two upgrades, but he also probably doesn't want to be weakest, and so he is willing to only go for one upgrade, then also be one of the two strongest, which might indicate that there are some strength events in there, because with Nostradamus, Payada has lots of knowledge about this next event deck. Siphon is the strongest in his seat, so no war. I'm was very happy about this because the war could have been quite ugly, but maybe also costly for Siphon because he maybe would miss out on some draws, but he could maybe just go for the military theory, but from his perspective I could maybe have some strong tactics, and so it is maybe a little bit dangerous for him. And I was very happy if he has one science more, then I think the danger of a war, if he has one, might be a lot bigger, because then he could also go for two upgrades from Warriors to Rifleman, which would put him at quite a bunch more strength. And Siphon actually goes for Steve Jobs here. I think Steve Jobs is indeed quite strong for him, helps him with the happy faces, and he has strong resources in science production, so he definitely will get a bunch of culture out of him, probably will be able to use him one turn. Once every turn, also gets the computer, so maybe even more often, so that will mean 4 additional culture every turn, and also helps with the happy face, as I said, so I think it's a strong leader for him, but I also, on the other hand, was quite happy about this. And to get out of corruption, he builds one more lab. Why was I happy about it? First of all, with not having Napoleon any longer, he is definitely reducing the military pressure, which gives me some room to breathe. And also with committing to Steve Jobs, I have now lost a big contender for Pierre, and Payada, Footloop both have no arenas at the moment, so that definitely increases my chances that I will get Pierre at some point. With already having 2 bread and circuses, I think Pierre would be quite nice for me. Also maybe with using the Olympic Games to punish a war, that also might help, so yeah. It is strong for Siphon, and I definitely can understand his decision. I think it might be the best for him, but I also was not unhappy about this. This turn I seed while being the weakest, which is maybe questionable. Payada went stronger with delaying his food production. It might indicate that there are some bad strength events in there. But on the other hand, yeah, I just felt like I'm a little bit behind, but I mean, I'm not really that much behind. I think I'd still have some nice things going for me, but I also thought that I really, really need the food, or could use the food from the prosperity that I seeded into the deck. And if I don't seed it now, there is a chance that all of my opponents seed. Maybe it's not that high of a chance, but it is definitely possible, and then I would not be able to put it into the next deck. And so I was willing to seed it now. At least I have knowledge about some bad strength events, but it is definitely a risk. And as you can see, I get punished for this, and the refugees are revealed. Losing one more population is definitely quite bad for me, and of course also losing the culture. And yeah, I actually lose one rifleman, which is quite costly. Losing the rifle, I could of course lose a knight. But my plan was that I maybe start transitioning into mechanized army, and maybe I will somehow be able to go for war with that, with going for mechanized armies, with having 6 military actions. So I thought it could be a way how I can approach this game. I'm not really sure, I don't have that much science. Can maybe hope to get one of the revolutionary ideas that might help. Yeah, so I went for the strategy. I copied the Conquistador's tactic now, so that at least gives me some more strength. And then I take the engineering genius, the patriotism, and the tanks, and with the tanks and the cannons in hand, hopefully I will be able to transition into mechanized army. In 2 turns I will have 15 science, that's just enough to go for both of those technologies, and if I should draw a war and maybe get revolutionary ideas, also getting air forces, then maybe going for a war with this mechanized army tactic could be an idea. And because of that, I was willing to lose the rifleman instead of the knight, even though the rifleman, of course, is more costly. And if I quit this plan again and maybe go for something different, then of course I definitely could regret it. But it also makes it possible to copy the Conquistador's tactic, meaning that I can at least have a decent amount of strength. With having those military technologies and patriotism and reserves in hand, I was hoping that I will be relatively safe from war, at least for the next turn. I draw another colonization card, which is nice, also 2 decent impacts. The impact of government is definitely playable, impact of technology maybe could be playable at some point. Footloop seeds, and the international agreement is opened. Siphon is the strongest player. Footloop goes for one more upgrade. It is relatively late, but it still might pay off. Then he goes through the revolutionary idea, the military theory, and the democracy. Payada seeds and another colony is revealed, and here I'm not quite sure if I made the right decision. Now, as you know, my plan was to transition into mechanized armies. I don't really need this rifleman if I want to do this, and this inhabited territory would just help me quite a lot. I lost another population because of the refugees. I get more yellow tokens, 2-3 population, so that just would be very strong, would help me a lot with the transition, and because of that I was actually willing to bid the rifleman plus all of my cards. Now, and sadly, I also have to send a rifleman plus all of my cards, but it is definitely also very, very dangerous, because now I can't defend against an aggression from Siphon. Yeah, so that is very dangerous. I could potentially still defend, but I just send away a lot of colonization cards. Yeah, my hope was that Siphon maybe wants to accept the international agreement. He has some hand space, and so he definitely can get quite a lot of value out of this international agreement. And maybe if he doesn't have a very strong aggression, he maybe prefers that instead of going for an aggression against me. But still, going for this colony is definitely quite dangerous, and I am not sure if it was the right decision. Payada upgrades the second farm, so the next turn he finally can get one more population out, takes the fundamentalism, the patriotism, and also one air force. And Siphon indeed takes the international agreement. I was very happy about this. He takes urban growth and reserves. I don't know if he had no aggression, or if he thought that this is better than going for an aggression, or if he maybe was afraid that I still can defend against a potential aggression from him. I have a bunch of military actions at least. But I definitely was very happy to not get hit by an aggression. With that, I also was quite happy to having gotten this colony. And then Siphon goes for operas, scoring for culture with Steve Jobs, builds one, builds another one, is now building up some culture production, isn't going for a lot of military, but also going for one upgrade to rifleman, putting him at 27 strength. This turn I am again the weakest, but now refugees are out, politics of strength and cold war in my hand, and I have at least some potentially nice impacts in hand, and the impact of government certainly will be quite nice for me, and so I see that and economic progress is revealed. And this turn, I was thinking if maybe, I was questioning if maybe if going for mechanized army and for more military is actually the right approach for me. I can go for cannons or for tanks maybe, and then for cannons at the next turn probably I would go for cannons first and for tanks, and maybe I will get air force plus revolutionary idea, but the big problem is I don't have a war yet, and I think it would be a big gamble if I don't get a war. Then Footloop maybe can increase his culture production, Payada already is quite ahead, Siphon is quite ahead, and if I go for this military and don't get a war, then it just isn't looking too great. I could maybe risk it, but the problem is if I don't get air forces and there's only one copy left, then it also might not be enough just going for cannons, tanks and this tactic. Maybe I could go for 3 armies, but also it isn't that easy for me to build up the necessary units while still drawing enough cards, and at the end I came to the conclusion that I maybe have a better shot at this game when I go for a peaceful approach. And so I made the decision to go for those multimedia. The good thing about the multimedia is, first of all, I gained one additional culture production thanks to Darwin, but that's maybe not the biggest point. But some other big points are that I have 2 nice impacts for it in hand. I have the impact of technology that might definitely be improved with going for the multimedia, and I have the impact of science. It might be hard to overtake Siphon, but I definitely have good chances to have more than Footloop and Payada, and maybe I can even managed to build 2 or 3 multimedias, which could leave me with a good shot at winning the impact of science even. So that works nicely with my impacts, produces me quite some culture, and I just felt like this is the better approach than hoping to draw a war, hoping to maybe get air forces and revolutionary idea, and I felt that going for military might not work out that nicely. If I go for military, I could maybe think about Churchill, maybe makes it He could be quite nice, going for cannons now, going for tanks at the next turn, but then I really would need a war, because I don't have a lot of culture production then, and I don't have that many draws left, so I rather went for the multimedia, building one multimedia, also rebuilding a rifleman, so I actually don't make the transition now, because I invest my science into multimedia. It is a little bit dangerous, but I was hoping that I still can somehow manage to defend myself, but it's definitely also a little bit risky. At the moment, Payada at the next turn I think isn't that much of a threat, but could potentially get a threat with having air forces in hand. Siphon went for just some culture production, so I was hoping that the other players won't go for a big military push, that I can defend against a small military push. And I take the reserves, take the engineering, and increase my population. The engineering I can develop at the next turn. If the other players stay very peaceful, then maybe I can go for it at the next turn, building more multimedias. If not, I maybe have to delay it and go for military technology. I just have enough science to go for tanks at least, maybe threatening the shock troops tactic and just having a way to get some upgrades in. I have now one copy of reserves and two more copies, one more copy of reserves of H3 and a patriotism, so quite a bunch of resources for my military, and I was just hoping that I can go for this additional culture production and preparation for impacts and still somehow defend myself. And I draw a tactic that definitely could help me with defending myself. the modern army. I don't have enough science to go for cannons and tanks at the next turn, but in two turns I would have, and this could be quite a nice tactic for me. Food loop opens the prosperity. I gain 4 food out of it. Siphon even gains 8 food out of it. But he has the ocean liner service anyways, and there's no Red Cross, so maybe this food isn't too important for him. Of course, it's still nice. Food loop goes for Chaplin. Is grabbing him, no, he grabs the movies for 3, is going for the movies, is going for Chaplin, building one movie, is going up to 11 culture production, and also building one swordsman, even with building one cavalryman, he wouldn't get out of corruption, because then one blue cube from there would have transferred in, then he would just have this blue token laying around here. So he goes for the swordsman, gives him the same amount of strength, but is cheaper, and so he's going up to 21 strength. And is revealing the classic army tactics, so that's definitely quite something that could also help me with defending myself, if I maybe can just prepare to copy this. Payada offers the International Tourism Pact to Siphon. That's definitely not good news for me, because Siphon gains 3 additional culture production and Payada even 4 additional culture production out of this. At least it's relatively late already, but still will produce, the pact will produce some culture for my opponents. Payada increases his population a bunch of times, and can even increase it that often that he has one unhappy face, allowing him to go for Mandela, so he finally has a leader again, and then he builds 2 religions, has now 3 additional happy faces, already getting quite a lot of culture out of Mandela, and he is also building 2 knights, going up to 30 strength. Siphon opens the freedom of movement, and then he puts one, I think, Breton Circuses into Opera, getting even more culture production, increasing his population, upgrading one more lab, is now at 11 science production, going for the internet and for the efficient upgrade, also upgrading one warrior to rifleman. Then it's my turn. As you can see, I see the impact of science. Now, I think it's very likely that I will finish that I will have more science production than Food Loop and then Payada. It will be difficult to have more than Siphon, but I thought that Siphon has probably the best position. He has a strong Wondermar now, has prepared very nicely for lots of impacts, and so I might not have a good chance to overtake him anyway. Maybe I have to just be happy about the third place and finishing before Food Loop, because Payada also has quite a big lead, is producing lots of culture with Mandela, but Payada is maybe not that nicely prepared for impact, so there's maybe still few hope left that I can overtake him, But no, it could just be a very big impact against Footloop, also potentially against Payada, and even if I still have a shot at overtaking Siphon, then with taking the cultural foreseeding into account, it only is -2 against Siphon, when Siphon is the will have the most science production, so it's not like it is a very big swing against him, and so I was willing to seed this into the deck, because the impact of Tech is at the moment, it's not that certain. If it indeed will be a good impact, probably it will be a fine impact, but it could then also be that it will be revealed too early, so I rather went for the impact of Science, and again seeding while being the weakest, but I have knowledge about a lot of H2 strength events by now, and the Arms Industry is revealed. I sadly don't gain any resource out of it. And when we take a look at the opponent civilization, Payada and Siphon both mainly increase their culture production, but I have to be careful because both of them also prepared to maybe go for a war if I am not careful. Payada built two knights, meaning with the patriotism he could go for a war, develop the air forces and go for two air forces. And the same is true for Siphon, he also could go for air forces, a war and build two air forces. Both of them are at 30 strength, so both of them could go up to 50 strength with that. But I have to be careful because Payada can go for even more because the freedom of movement will be available for him. So he could even maybe put a worker from somewhere into maybe modern infantry and then still, maybe with the help of the Louvre, go for two air forces, and that would even put him at 55 strength. Now, and this turn was a little bit of a puzzle, because I wanted to prepare as nicely as I can to score as much culture as I can in the next three turns, but I also have to find a way to defend myself. And that wasn't easy, and I really wanted to put a worker with the freedom of movement from alchemy to multimedia, and I was really searching for quite some time until I found a turn that I was happy with. Because if I don't find a way to how I can defend myself with putting a worker from alchemy into multimedia, then I maybe have to use the freedom of movement differently, putting a worker maybe into military, but it would be quite bad. Not using freedom of movement also would feel quite bad. So I was really hoping that I would find a solution to defend myself by also doing this. And at the end I indeed found a solution. And also a solution that doesn't involve Churchill. Of course he could help, but it also would mean that I don't get a PL, and I'm the only one without an H3 leader, so unless he isn't under card draw, I will be guaranteed that I can take him at my next turn. I take the military builder, which of course will be an important card. I take the reserves, I need every resource that I can get. I first thought that I maybe want to prepare for classic armies that I will be able to copy to with the air forces, but it is actually better, and I came to the conclusion that it is better to prepare just for two modern armies. But for that I need every resource that I can get. I play the reserves 2 for resources, I go for 1 cannon, build 1 cannon, and then I have some civil actions left. I definitely have to get out of corruption, and no. But before I talk about my last two civil actions, let's first of all take a look at what I can do at my next turn with my military. I will have 7 resources at my next turn, plus the military buildup is +9, I can play the modern army tactic, then I will have even less strength, so I think it's for certain that I will be able to get it for 9 resources, so 9, and I have 3 other yellow cards for 4, so that's +21, +7 is +28, so I will be a 28 resource at my next turn. And to fulfill 2 modern army tactics, I need 3 more cannons, 1 more rifleman, no, the other way around, 1 more cannon, 3 more rifleman. That will be 4 units, meaning that costs me 20 resources, and then I also need to upgrade both tanks, both knights to tanks, and that requires from 3 to 7, 2 times 8 more resources, so 20 plus 8 is 28, and it's just the amount of resource I will have at the end, so it just is working out. And of course I also have to be careful because that requires a lot of military actions. 4 units, 2 upgrades, revealing the tactic requires 7 military actions, but I have 6 plus the patriotism, so I'm just able to go for this, and when we take a look at how much strength it will give me, 4 units will give me 12 strength, 2 upgrades another 6, so 18 strength, and instead of 5 from the conquistadors I will have 26 from the modern army, so plus 21 and plus 18 is plus 39, and that means that I will be able to go up to 59, and with that I should be safe from a war from Payada. So it took me quite a while, because I was at the wrong rank at the moment. I thought I might rather want to prepare for Classic Army with Air Forces, but it just didn't work out very nicely. Yeah. So after I figured out how I can defend myself, I also have to think about what I want to do at my next turn. And there are two things that I really would love to do. First of all, I want to take Pierre, and I have to be prepared to maybe even take him for three civil actions. And it would be amazing if I would be able to go get a Wonder, maybe ideally Fast Food Chains, but also the Hollywood could work. Maybe even the Manhattan Project, but that one will be discarded probably. Now, however, that could require lots of civil actions, and because of that I actually increased my population two times at my next turn, with my last two civil actions. I thought about taking the satellites. However, taking the satellites maybe makes it even more likely that the age will end, meaning that when I take Pierre, then I actually would have to elect him without getting the civil actions back. So when I take more cards from the row, on one hand maybe then the cards will be on a cheaper area of the civil action area, but yeah, it could also be that the age will end, which could also make it more expensive to go for PR. But the biggest reason to increase my population another time even is that I at the next turn don't have corruption. That makes the difference. If I don't increase it now, I will have corruption, meaning that I have to increase it maybe the next turn to get out of corruption. But I might need every civil action at my next turn. Because now I could just grab Pierre for three civil actions at the next turn for three, elect him, and also still grab a Wonder for five civil actions. So even if both Pierre and a Wonder are on three, I could still go for it. Only if the age ends and both Pierre and a Wonder are on three civil actions, then I would not be able to go for this. It's definitely not certain that a Wonder will be available. Food Loop, for example, could go for Fast Food Chains and the Hollywood. So if the Hollywood is maybe available in his turn, he could take it. And if then the Fast Food Chains are available on Payada's turn, he could take it. It's another reason why I didn't want to take the satellites or also the Air Forces, because revealing more cards makes it more likely that a Wonder will be available already for Food Loop or Payada at their turns. Now, and not having corruption at the next turn is also quite important when I will go for the Hollywood. Because if I grab the Hollywood at the next turn, then in two turns I will have 7 plus another 6 is 13 resources, plus 8 from the reserves is 21, plus the engineering genius is 26 when I go for the Hollywood. For the fast food chains I get only 4 resources out of this, but when I go for the Hollywood I will have 26 resources at my last turn. And that means that if I just grab Pierre and the Hollywood at the next turn, then at my last turn I can develop the engineering, build one more multimedia and one more Bread and Circuses for Pierre, and finish the Hollywood, which hopefully will give me a bunch of culture. I also can go for a Nobel Prize at my last turn. And then I have 3 multimedias plus the Hollywood, meaning that I at least get 18 culture out of the Hollywood, which is of course not amazing, but definitely is still a fine amount. Yeah. So like this, with this turn I'm prepared to defend against the war, and if a Wonder and Pierre is available for me, I can go for it, because I don't have corruption, I can just use all of my civil actions for it if needed. And then I have enough resources to finish the Wonder and to also do some additional stuff, like as I said, building a multimedia, maybe building a Bread and Circuses. Yeah. But that was quite a difficult turn, and it took me quite a long time to find the right solution. I draw 2 impacts, but both of them are not too great, but could be playable, maybe. And I was very happy to see that there's no Hollywood or no Wonder at all at Footloop's turn on the row. Footloop seats and the first impact is revealed. It is the impact of Harmony. 24 all of my opponents, only 16 for me, so definitely not great, but also not a horrible impact. Footloop, I think, put one more worker into military with the freedom of movement. He also has to be a little bit careful. Goes for 2 movies and plays the revolutionary idea, takes the air forces and the satellites. The next turn he has enough for 2 air forces and 1 cavalryman, so he's definitely prepared for military. Payada also can't go for a war, goes for an impact. The impact of agriculture is revealed. That's plus 8 for Footloop and plus 10 for all of the other players. And then Payada goes for operas, definitely will produce him some culture, and he's maybe a little bit unlucky because there is no Wonder available for him on the row. maybe where the fast food chains would be there, then he could maybe just go for the fast food chains. On the other hand, then he also couldn't do that much else because it would require quite a bunch of his resources, but would probably definitely still be worth it. But like this, he will get even more production, and he takes some technologies, is also developing the cavalry man, meaning he is scoring a Nobel Prize right now, and with rockets and mechanized agriculture and a revolutionary idea in hand, he has just enough science to go for one more Nobel Prize also at the next turn. He is taking a lot of cards, so he is probably, he prefers to anti-age, and yeah, so and then at the next turn he gets one more big production, one more Nobel Prize, and so and that's at least also not too bad, even though he doesn't get a wonder, and at the moment he also isn't prepared for a wonder, even if maybe one would be left at his next turn. As you can see, Fast Food Chains and Pierre are both in the row, so Fast Food Chains will be cheaper for me, and with that I probably will take that instead of the Hollywood. The civil unrest is revealed, no one has any unhappy workers, Siphon takes the efficient upgrade, goes for computers, and doing one upgrade, builds a religion, takes the bro sports, also develops the cannons, scores a Nobel Prize, the next turn he has enough for air forces and bro sports, going for another Nobel Prize, and then, very interestingly, he builds a farm. It's interesting because Impact of Agriculture and Impact of Harmony are both already out of the deck. That farm helps for that, so there's only one impact left where the farm would be nice, and that is the Impact of Balance. So that actually might be a sign that the Impact of Balance isn't a deck. And then also Siphon builds one stage of the internet already. Also getting one population out with the ocean liner service. He isn't ending the age, I was very happy to see this, that gives me one additional civil action. On the other hand, if he takes one more card, then the fast food chains would be one cheaper for me, so it probably doesn't make a difference at the end. Unless I will grab the technology with Darwin. This turn I see the impact of technology in there. Now it's relatively clear that it will be a nice impact for me. Not a very strong impact, but definitely a fine impact. And will score me probably, or will score me some additional points against Footloop and Payada. And it also is now in the next deck, so there is not a threat that it will be revealed too early. The impact of government is revealed. I seeded it in earlier, plus 18 for Footloop, plus 20 for Payada. Plus 21 for Siphon and plus 22 for me, so I gain the most out of it, but it's not a big swing against the other players. And then this turn I can go for Pierre, I can go for the fast food chains, and then I even have two civil actions left. I thought about going for the Hollywood, because the Hollywood is quite a bit better for Footloop, but also not that much. He also has quite a nice fast food chains, as you can see, there's a lot of populations available. The Hollywood would be better, but it also would be worse for me, it would cost more civil action, so I think that doesn't make sense at the end. And yeah, so I went for the fast food chains, then I have two civil actions left. And there's a small problem maybe, because I kinda would like to build a Bretton Circuses already, but oh no, there is actually isn't a problem. Because when I go for the Hollywood at the next turn, I would be able to go for the engineering and to go for Bretton Circuses in the multimedia, but it isn't possible anyway with the fast food chains, because the engineering genius only gives me 4 resources. So I wouldn't be able to go for Bretton Circuses and the multimedia anyway. And with that, I just went for one Bretton Circuses this turn already without the engineering, because I want to use it for a Nobel Prize at the next turn. And then I even went for also one more religion, just getting one more cultural production already this turn. This is a nice preparation for the impact of variety, it's also a nice preparation for the impact of happiness, and just produces me some additional culture. And yeah, and at the next turn I will have still enough resources to finish the fast food chains, go for a Nobel Prize, and thanks to the military build-up I might even be able to build some more military units, maybe even making sure that I won't be the weakest, maybe even the strongest after my turn. So because of that I was really hoping that there is no impact of strength revealed before my next turn. With that the age will end, and sadly I don't draw another impact, but at least I have a playable one maybe. And when we take a look at the culture, we can see that Payada is in the lead. Siphon is not that much behind him, and he will get a big wonder, so I think Siphon has still the best position. But I will get the Olympic Games, I will get a wonder, so there is maybe still a chance left that I catch up to Payada, but Payada will also again generate quite a lot of culture, with Mandela will also get a Nobel Prize, so it might be difficult. And Footloop, we also shouldn't count him out, because he will get quite a big Hollywood, and he is also not that badly prepared for some impacts. Footloop Seeds, so one more impact is revealed, and it is the impact of Science. That of course is now quite nice for me against Footloop and against Payada, and of course also quite strong for Siphon. Footloop can go for the Democracy thanks to the Acropolis, and he can also go for the Satellites, scoring a Nobel Prize, and then he has just enough civil actions left to take the Hollywood and to finish the Hollywood for 32 culture, so definitely not a bad last turn. Is now a 22 culture reduction, gets a Nobel Prize and gets a 32 culture Hollywood. Payada tries an aggression against me, but I can defend, and luckily at my last draw I also draw a second defense card, so I could also defend another aggression from Siphon if he should go for one. Payada can, thanks to the Revolutionary Idea, go for Mechanized Agriculture and Rockets, which gives him one more Nobel Prize. He plays the Patriotism, increases population, builds one more Opera, upgrades some Knights to Cavalryman, making him stronger, also giving him some more points for potential impact of competition, and then he's taking the multimedia, scoring again quite a lot of culture, also getting a Nobel Prize. Siphon Seeds, it is not the impact of strength, I was always afraid that it might be revealed. It is the impact of happiness, so plus 16 for all of my opponents, plus 14 for me, but at least I was able to upgrade this impact at my last turn with going for Britain Circuses and for a religion. And Siphon also can go for one Nobel Prize, also scoring a lot of culture with Steve Jobs. Then he is playing the Reserves for Resources, can upgrade his one arena to Pro Sports, that will be nice for some impacts, and also gives him 3 additional culture from the internet. And then he has the internet for 25 culture, that's definitely not bad, and also gets Nobel Prize, and definitely, I think, has the strongest position going into the impacts. This turn I can use the Olympic Games, and yeah, I think the decision for my politics phase will now depend on whether I want to play it safe and maybe make sure that I finish before Footloop, or if I maybe want to still try my best to even overtake Payada. And I did some calculations, and I thought about it a little bit, and I thought that I should rather focus about overtaking Payada than making sure that I finish before Footloop. If I would want to make sure that I finish before Footloop, it would maybe just be the best to not see it and to make sure that that if the impact of strength is in there, that it isn't revealed now at my turn, because that would be a very big swing. Footloop, it would be a plus 15 for Footloop, and that could be one way how he could maybe overtake me. Now, but I instead made a decision to seed. It's only a small risk, and if the impact of strength isn't revealed or definite impact that will be improved during my turn, then it is also nice against Footloop. It has the impact of population that will be 2 better for Footloop, but with seeding it's basically 1 better for me, and it will be 2 better for me against Payada, so with seeding plus 5 against Payada, and with that I seeded impact of population, and it will be better for Siphon, but I think Siphon is out of reach anyway, and so I seeded this into the deck. The impact of colonies is revealed, plus 6 for Footloop, plus 3 for Payada, plus 0 for Siphon, and plus 6 for me, so that is quite a nice impact for me. It is not impact of strength, so that went all fine up to this point. And then I can use the engineering genius for the fast food chains, I can develop the engineering, the tanks, I can increase my population, playing military build-up, building one rifleman, building one tank, and then I can reveal the modern army tactic, meaning that now I'm the strongest instead of the weakest. Also, I can put one more worker, some more workers into something. That gives me also some additional points for the fast food chains. And I can finish it for 23 culture, also gaining a Nobel Prize, having the Olympic Games. So I think all of the players really did a lot out of their last turns. And then we can take a look at the culture before the final impacts. And we can see that Siphon is in the lead, Payada is at 219 and I am 8 culture behind, but Footloop is also only 13 culture behind me, so still there can a lot happen, and yeah, I can maybe still end up at the last place, I can still have chances to end up at the second place. Probably Siphon is not really, it's not possible to reach him because he's also very nicely prepared for many impacts, but who knows, maybe there's also something possible. The first one is the impact of balance, that's very strong for Siphon, and as I said, when he built his farm, that also was kind of an indicator that his impact is in the deck. And it's also Bless 4 for me against Payada, also better for me than Footloop, so a good impact for me to start with. Then the impact of Architecture, plus 16 for Siphon, plus 6 for Payada, plus 10 for me, so I have now the same amount of culture, and plus 11 for Footloop, so Footloop is catching up a bit. Then there is the impact of Tech, plus 16 for Siphon, plus 12 for Payada, plus 16 for me, and plus 12 for Footloop, so now I'm even at the second place. And then the impact of Competition, plus 11 for Siphon, plus 14 for me, plus 12 for Payada, and plus 10 for Footloop. So another nice impact for me. And then the impact of Population that I seeded at my last turn, plus 24 for Siphon, plus 16 for me, plus 14 for Payada, and plus 18 for Footloop. So there's one impact left. Payada is 8 culture behind me, and Footloop is now 16 culture behind Payada. And the last impact is the impact of Progress, plus 12 for Siphon, plus 18 for me, plus 10 for Payada, and actually plus 20 for Footloop, so he catches up quite a bit, but it is not enough, and so here we have our final standing. Siphon is able to win this game with definitely a bit of a lead. I'm at the second position, Payada is at the third position, and Footloop is at the fourth position. Yeah, I actually was very happy about this finish. For the most times of H3, I thought that I can be happy when I finish third place, or that this may be a realistic outcome, that I maybe finish before Footloop, but Payada just had such a big of a lead, and also definitely is not too bad prepared for impacts, but at the end, he wasn't definitely in those impacts, he was weaker. Maybe there were some where he would be better, like Impact of Culture, for example. At the end, I was prepared better for some impacts. Yeah, but still, during most of H3, I thought it would be very hard to finish better than third place, and I thought that it is more realistic that I will finish at the fourth place instead of that I finish at the second place, so I'm very happy about this outcome. I think I've had a relatively nice position, but then when I got hit by rats, I had not a lot of population, and that put me into a dangerous position. Luckily, Siphon was missing one science to go for military theory and military technology. That maybe then he would have gone for a more aggressive play. But I then somehow was able to keep up with the military. Then there was this important turn where I figured out how I can defend myself while still preparing for a nice culture push, and then I also definitely was a little bit lucky that I was able to get one of those wonders, and Payada was unlucky, he also could have gotten the fast food chains, and then together with Pierre I got the Olympic Games. I was quite nicely prepared for some impacts. I think the turn when I went for the multimedia also was a key decision. I think preparing for war maybe could have worked. I did draw war at the end, although I think it was my last turn when I drew this, so I think it would have been very difficult. First of all, I need to draw a war, and then even if I draw a war, it is not for certain that I actually can get enough strength, because the other players also could go for some amount of strength, or maybe at least threaten some amount of strength. So I think that was a key decision, and definitely also was lucky that I didn't get punished by an aggression after I won this colony. Now, and so at the end, I finish at the second place. Payada, basically here. Maybe he thought he is playing the Squid Game tournament, because in the Squid Game tournament I just played a game where I only was allowed to have an H1 leader and an H3 leader. In this tournament, if you don't know it, there are a lot of special rules. Yeah, so maybe Payada was training for that special mode. But skipping the HA leader maybe didn't turn out too great for him. And then after I took Darwin for 3, he also didn't have a nice H2 leader available for him. And but Mandela at the end did, of course, also give him quite a lot of culture. Yeah, and now that we have the result of this game, we can also take a look at the standings after this game was finished. And at the standings we can see that, of course, Watsinets is still on top. I think it is the only game that finished compared to the standings that you saw at the beginning of the video. So Watsinets still at 13 points after 3 games finished, but with the 3 points that I got from this game, I'm also now at 9 points after 3 games, which is definitely not too bad, and with 4 points behind with being 4 points behind Watson yet, there are definitely still chances that I can maybe overtake him. Cengiz Sip also has 3 games finished with 7 points. Then there is Payada, who has 6 points but already has 4 games finished, so he needs some good results in his last 3 games, otherwise he is in danger of getting relegated. But of course, he scored points in every game, but he just wasn't able to win a game or to get a lot of good results, but he also never was last place. And then we have Siphon. He lost his first game, but now that was his second game, he won it, is now at 6 points. Also definitely doesn't have a bad position. Lemmings player has 2 games finished with 5 points, but with only having 2 games finished, there's also still everything possible for him. And then at the last position is Footloop. He has 1 more loss now and is at 2 points after 3 games finished. So he also is in a dangerous position and needs some more points in his next games. Yeah, so I hope it was an interesting game for you, and with that, have a nice time and see you in the next video.